listeners, welcome to episode 3 of the Blindside Rugby Podcast with me, your host, Chris Hutton. Thank you very much for joining me this week. There's a lot of news both in South Africa and internationally in terms of rugby, so let's get right into it. Regarding player news, Malcolm Marks has re-signed with the South African Rugby Union until 2021. This includes a sabbatical after this year's Rugby World Cup, so that's good news obviously for the Springboks and for the Lions. Tendai Mtawarira, known colloquially and maybe internationally as the Beast, his autobiography has been recalled by the publishers. It was set to be released on the 1st of July, but there has been a backlash related to controversial comments regarding former Springbok coach Pieter de Villiers. I'm sure many of you will remember Pieter de Villiers, either fondly or not so fondly. The Beast himself said that he wants to focus on his preparations for the World Cup, so I think credit to him. He doesn't want news off the field to distract from the preparations for the World Cup, either for himself or for his fellow players. In terms of coaching news, Stephen Larkham, the former Australian fly half, has been appointed head coach of Munster. It'll be interesting to see how he gets on. And then Daryl Gibson has left the Waratahs with 1 year left on his contract. I'm sure all of you are aware of the Israel Folau controversy in Australia, and the Waratahs haven't really played well this season or the last few seasons. I think they've been underperforming. So it seems like Daryl has had enough of that franchise and he has now left the Waratahs. In England news, Eddie Jones, the England head coach, in an interview with the Times this week, he revealed some interesting things from behind the scenes, and I'll give you a few quotes here. We'll start off where he said that if you have financial security and depth of players, you should be one of the top three countries in the world most of the time, and that hasn't been the case. So I always thought there was an opportunity to do things better. But then you get into the game here and find out why. It's a difficult job because it's a battleground between the clubs and the Rugby Football Union, and you sit in the middle, and you are blamed for most things, and that's been the tricky part. I feel you're always being held back, end quote. So Jones revealing some stuff of what's going on in the background, how difficult it is to manage the England team. Maybe we always assume if either clubs or countries have a lot of money, then they're automatically going to be successful. But I suppose with more money comes more, I don't know, intrigue and politics and political interference. So, you know, people like to point to South African sport as a basket case, but other countries also, I think, have their issues. Further on in the podcast, Jones, who is also a keen observer of different coaching methods and rival sports codes, said he often manufactured problems to test the resourcefulness of his players and staff. And here's another quote. I have set up team meetings and not turned up, set up training sessions and not turned up. Allow the opportunity for your players and staff to fail because that's the way they learn the most. I know that's end quote there, sorry. That's another interesting approach. Maybe trying to get his players and fellow coaches to think on their feet. And this feeds into what he said next, where he said, and I quote, because the players lead such controlled lives, particularly in any professional sports, they have probably gone from a sports high school, everything laid out for them, to an academy, then a professional team. So they have a small range of experience and you have to create different experiences, end quote. That probably feeds into the idea of, you know, on the field, if a player gets a yellow card or something, then how does the team adapt? You can't always control these things. So how good are you at thinking on your feet? And if you grew up in a very controlled environment, then it'll be difficult to adapt. So interesting stuff from that interview. If you have some time, I would encourage you to go and listen to that. Again, just to remind you, it's from the Times. And then just for England news generally, for the Rugby World Cup, they're in the same pool with France, Argentina, Tonga, and the United States. So that's pretty easy group for them, I think, to win. Maybe Argentina will prove the toughest team for them to play against, but they should be fairly confident of topping that group. But of course, we'll see what happens in the World Cup. In New Zealand news, and this is pretty big for the whole All Black setup, Mike Cron, that's his surname is C-R-O-N, Cron, he'll be stepping down from his role as All Blacks forwards coach after the World Cup. He's sort of going to take a new background role, mentoring and developing players and coaches. He's been in the New Zealand setup for 16 years. He has coached and formed players such as Tony Woodcock, Kevin Mialamu, Owen Franks, and countless others. And just those names, I mean, they're real bastions of All Black rugby. For this coach to have an impact, to have had an impact and trained all these players, I think is testament to his track record, his expertise, his level of professionalism. You know, it stands, I guess, the test of time. In an interview with the New Zealand Herald, he said, and I quote, they are special. They don't suffer fools. And now he's talking about forwards. A lot of them don't waste too many words and sentences. They keep it simple, but it's not to say that they're not bright. they keep things black and white, and that's the way I like it. We all know where we stand. They work hard and they get on with it, end quote. So it's some fun sort of tongue-in-cheek insight, I think, into the world of forwards. Myself as a backline player, maybe backline players look down a bit on the forwards and didn't think much of them. Cron also said that his favorite test result, and maybe game in general, was the remarkable comeback victory in Soweto in 2010 when the All Blacks scored two tries in the final 3 minutes when Israel Dagg scored the winning try. He received the pass from Ma Nonu, who was wearing one boot at the time. I remember watching that game at university in the common room at my dorm at Rhodes University. That was also one of my favorite All Blacks memories. On that day, you know, unfortunately for John Smith, the former Springbok captain, it was his 100th test, and there were about 94,000 fans at Soccer City, and the All Blacks won that game. Cron himself sits on 199 tests, not out with the All Blacks. He's been involved in the All Blacks environment since 2004, sorry. So that's obviously an amazing record. He leaves with two World Cups and an 88.5% win record under coach Steve Hansen since 2012. From 2004 till 2011, he worked exclusively on the scrum. But for the past 7 years, he has also added the responsibility of overseeing the breakdown, kickoffs, and lineouts. It's sort of, I think, a good lesson for many of us, maybe in life in general. He has taken snippets from ballet, cage fighting, shot put, sumo wrestlers, baseball, ice hockey, and the NFL, just to name a few. So the importance of being willing to learn from different sports. One shouldn't just be confined to rugby or, you know, in your work. Don't just confine yourself to your current industry. Be willing to learn from other things which you might not even expect will have application for your own work. With each passing year, you know, we've sort of seen his influence evolving in the All Blacks. It's involved more ball in play, more passing, tackling, ground covered, and the quicker pace, which now also requires props and hookers to have more fully rounded skills. I think if you look at Dane Coles and Cody Taylor specifically, they've carved sort of a niche of their own by playing on the wing and emulating the centers. They're very good at offloading, and we see that influence now in other teams as well. Cron also, of course, made the point of being very grateful to Steve Hansen, who's a former police colleague of his, for giving him his lucky break with Canterbury in the late 90s and taking him through to the Crusaders and onto Wales, where they coached their first of five World Cups in 2003. And this sort of relationship and history to me just shows the absolutely vital importance of building relationships and continuity to develop a playing and coaching philosophy. You shouldn't think that these things can just change overnight. Maybe that's sort of, I guess, a problem for the Springboks, how quickly things change, especially with political interference. There needs to be much more sort of security so that the players can also be developed and coached, I think, in a better, more consistent way. In terms of, I guess, the greatest players he's coached, Cron said, I saw Richie McCaw when he was 18 or 19 because he played with my son for Christchurch Colts. The first time I ever saw him, I thought, phew, I had never seen a kid with the mental side of the game at that age. When I was watching him play, I could actually see that he was thinking all the time. He was so bright, he could be waiting for play to finish at his feet. He was that far ahead of play, you know. Extremely bright young man. He could read the game like no one else I had ever seen, end quote. And that's, you know, what more can I say about Richie McCaw that hasn't been said? To me, the greatest All Black of all time. But to have a coach of Mike Cron's stature talking about Richie in those words, I think is testament to Richie as a player and also as a man. So, you know, sad news that Cron is leaving the All Blacks, but I'm sure he'll try and be involved as much as he can in the future. And now we'll have to see after the World Cup who the new All Blacks head coach is and who he brings in and what sort of impact that'll have on the All Blacks as a team. But, you know, as the saying goes, one door closes and another door opens up. I want to shine a little bit of a spotlight here on Sevu Reese, the wing for the Crusaders, who's had an amazing season. he did a little interview for the All Blacks YouTube channel. And he, it's very nice to see how effusive he is in talking about the Crusaders and his experience so far. Obviously, when you score as many tries as he had, you're going to talk very positively, but it was just nice to hear. He says one little story. He talked about when Scott Robertson called him before the season, he ignored the first call because he thought it was a friend playing a prank call on him. And then when Robertson called him back and he messaged him, and then he saw that it was Robertson, and he called him back immediately and obviously then accepted the call to train with the Crusaders. Rhys grew up and played in Fiji, and he never played on the wing until the Mitre 10 competition. The vibe you get from the interview is that he's very happy with the Crusaders and the environment. It seems to be one where players are encouraged to learn and ask questions. When he came for the preseason, he didn't expect to play. And now you never know. Maybe he'll get called into the All Blacks for the World Cup, or at least into the wider training group. So we'll have to see what happens. But just a nice little story with Mike Cron announcing that he'll be leaving the All Blacks. You know, there's always new players and new coaches coming up. And nice to keep an eye on these things. In local news, Bulls coach Puete Iman guided his side to their first playoff appearance since 2013. In an interview this week, he just talked about how worried he is for the future of the team. Number 8 and vice-captain Dwayne Vermeulen, Arche Snyman and Jason Jenkins, as well as center Jesse Creel, have all signed contracts with Japanese teams, so they'll all be going overseas. And then the captain for this year, Luat Diakhar, whose season was ended prematurely by injury, and his stand-in skipper, Andre Pollard, have also joined youngsters Snyman, Andre Liebenberg, and Hendre Stassen in signing long-term contracts with European side. So a big exodus from the Bulls, and it'll be interesting to see how and if they can rebuild, what sort of young players they're going to bring in. For the Springboks, Frans Steyn, Kobus Reinach, Marcel Kutsia, and Reinhard Elstad have all been called up to the 26-man squad for a Springbok alignment camp. And this team met, this sort of alignment camp met this past Sunday. They don't include the South African teams who were included in the playoffs the past week, but those players will come in. So the squad gathered in Pretoria on Sunday for the next installment of the National Alignment and Conditioning Camps. The Springboks continue their preparations for the forthcoming international season. Coach Rassie Erasmus is clearly trying to play, you know, maybe like a big picture role, trying to make sure that things are in place before the World Cup so that they don't feel like they're ill-prepared for the World Cup coming up. And then lastly, also on the Springboks, Duncan Johnston, writing on stuff.co.nz. That's a website I'd recommend you all check out. There's also always really good news there in terms of New Zealand rugby. He feels that the Springboks just became an even more dangerous threat before the World Cup. There's no South African team in the semifinals, so he feels that they can prepare a lot better now. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on this, listeners. Do you think the Springboks are going to benefit from none of the players being involved in the semifinals and the final? Obviously, you want these teams to be vying for the Super Rugby title, but maybe in a World Cup year, everyone's focused on the World Cup. No one's really going to remember who won Super Rugby. So we'll see if it is actually beneficial for the Springboks. Just a reminder, the first Springbok game of the Rugby Championship this year is on the 21st of July, when South Africa hosts Australia. Okay, that's all the news done for this week. Let's talk about the latest results. In Super Rugby, the Crusaders against the Highlanders. Here for this game, I picked the Crusaders to win by 10, and they eventually won 38 points to 14. I thought watching the game, it was a crazy first half. Both sides attacked pretty well. The Highlanders showed some good defense, and it was fairly tight in the first half. In the second half, Liam Squire got a yellow card for a no-arms tackle, and I don't think he was malicious. It was just he didn't wrap his arm around Fetu Douglas, and unfortunately then for him, he received the yellow card. From the resulting penalty and line-out, the Crusaders scored a try through a few phases, and that then held the Crusaders then set out a lead of 24 points to 14. It was a very costly yellow card for Squire. The Crusaders scored two tries while he was off. In the second half, they completely shut out the Highlanders and scored 21 unanswered points. I thought fly half Richie Moanga was very good again, very prominent, sort of guiding things around. He scored two tries. His second try especially, the way he chased chase the kick through was quite admirable. So he'll be crucial for them in their semi-final. Then in the second quarterfinal, the Jaguares beat the Chiefs 21 points to 16. Here I picked the Jaguares to win by 7, so I got that one at least closer than the first game. This was a proper arm wrestle, very tough rugby. The Jaguares made a fantastic start, scored in the first minute. Then it sort of settled into a pattern of kickback and forcing the other team back. The Chiefs enjoyed the majority of territory, but the Jaguares were very good defensively, especially near their own 22. I thought they were very good with their line speed. The Chiefs looked directionless for me at crucial times. Maybe that shows how much they're missing Damien McKenzie. On 20 minutes, the Jaguares built some really good continuity. They built up over 11 phases and then earned a penalty to give them an 8-0 lead. I think the Jaguares, and probably Argentina as well, they've been guilty of lapses over the years. I thought they sort of build well, then they make a disciplinary mistake or knock the ball on, that kind of thing. An example of this, they thought they had a penalty and stopped playing, and then the Chiefs got the ball. After a good dummy and break by Brad Weber, the Chiefs then got their first try. So they're guilty of these lapses in concentration, I think. After the first half, the Chiefs led by 10 points to 8. The Chiefs were a bit more patient in the second half. They built a lead, but nothing flashy. And then, I don't know what exactly it was. Maybe they said at halftime that they would really get fired up at some point, but the Jaguares, sort of the second half of the second half, they played a lot better. They applied a lot more pressure. And eventually they earned a penalty to take the lead back. I thought their fly half, Bunila, played really well. He was very reliable and kicked very well for posts and for the line. In the last 10 minutes, the Jaguares defended really well. They pinned the Chiefs in their own 22, and then they deservedly won with a penalty at a breakdown. And I think they'll be tough to beat in the semifinal. In the third quarterfinal, the Hurricanes beat the Bulls by 35 points to 28. And in that game, I picked the Hurricanes to win by 10. So another close-ish pick that I almost got right. It wasn't too much of a contest in the first half. The Bulls made 6 handling errors in the first half. They didn't challenge the Hurricanes on attack, and they really were their own worst enemies. I thought the Bulls were a lot better in the second half, and it's credit to them that they pulled the game back to 28-32. There was a lot more ramped up pace in the second half, a few close moments with both teams trying their utmost to break through, and possession was pretty much equal. But by that point, the Hurricanes had built up a good enough buffer to close out the game. And then in the final quarterfinal, the Brumbies beat the Sharks by 38 points to 13. In that one, I picked the Brumbies to win by 10. So maybe I was a bit too kind to the Sharks there. The Brumbies made a fantastic start. Pete Samu scored a try in the first minute. The Brumbies were clinical. I felt the Sharks forwards never really got into the game. Just one, I guess, example of how the Sharks struggled. In the 63rd minute, they had an attacking lineup, and they just knocked the ball on. You know, you can't, when you have those opportunities at this level of rugby, you have to take every chance you get. Joe Powell sealed the game on 71 minutes. He broke out from a ruck and ran straight through to score. So there was no pillar defense from the Sharks, so pretty lazy defending from them. The Brumbies had very little possession in the second half, but they managed to keep the Sharks relatively quiet. The Sharks had a lot of possession, but couldn't do much with it, really. A disappointing end to the season for the Sharks, but I don't really think that they deserve to go any further in the competition, at least not based on that result. Right, so that's all the results. Moving on to the predictions for the coming week, we've got semi-final rugby this weekend. On Saturday at 9:35 a.m. South African time, the Hurricanes travel to Christchurch to play against the Crusaders. I think this will be the pick of the fixtures for this weekend. I was watching the Extra Time show on the All Blacks YouTube channel with Piri Wipu. He highlighted the Crusaders' consistency and intensity. He himself is a former Hurricanes player, but he really pointed out how consistent the Crusaders have been over the last few years and how difficult it is to match them. This is also going to be a battle of, I think, Richie Moonga versus Bowden Barrett. As great a season as Moonga has had, I still think All Blacks coach Steve Hansen is going to pick Bowden Barrett to start for the All Blacks, but Moonga can only sort of reinforce his case to start if he performs well in this game, and I'm sure he will. I think the Crusaders forwards are definitely going to have too much for the Hurricanes. I don't think the Canes, they can play really good attacking rugby, but they need forward, front football. And I don't think the Crusaders forwards, led by Sam Whitelock and Kieran Reid, I don't think they're really going to allow them to get into the game. For the Hurricanes, I guess a player to watch is Beauden Barrett, Jordy Barrett, Ben Lamb, Nani Lamape. That's a seriously good backline, and we'll see what they can do. Maybe if their forwards get into the game, they can really challenge the Crusaders at the breakdown. But for me, just with the Crusaders, how they've been playing for the last three seasons now, the players they have, the experience, the depth, and the home ground advantage, I'm picking the Crusaders to win that game by 7 points. Then the second, actually, technically, this is the first semi-final, if you think about it. Yeah. This is on Saturday at 1:05 a.m., so 1 a.m. in the morning, South African time. The Jaguares are hosting the Brumbies in Argentina. This is the Jaguares' first appearance in a semi-final. They've now been in the competition for 4 years, and this is their first appearance in a semi-final, so I think a pretty impressive trajectory there, reflecting well on them. I think the Brumbies loose forwards need to get it stuck into this game right from the beginning. Pete Samu is going to be crucial for them. Their outside backs are bigger than the Jaguares players. They need to get the ball to them as quickly as possible. And then I think they can stand a chance. But the Jaguares, as I mentioned before in their game against the Chiefs, they were really, really good defensively, very good line speed. Obviously think the home crowd will fire them up. We know how passionate and vocal Argentinian fans can be when Argentina and the Jaguares are playing at home. So it's going to be a challenge for the Brumbies. If the Jaguares can sort of nullify the Brumbies forwards, I think they could very well win this game and then make it into their first ever final, which will be, I think, very good. A very good reflection on their work ethic and how they've improved over the years in the competition. So there you have it, the two semi-finals. Just to remind you, in Super Rugby this year, the Crusaders hosting the Hurricanes and the Jaguares hosting the Brumbies. And for both games, I've got the home teams winning by 7 points, and we'll see how close I get those predictions when we do the review next week. Right, moving on from Super Rugby to the World Under Rugby Under 20 Championship. In the third, fourth playoff, so for the bronze medal, South Africa beat Argentina by 41 points to 16. This was a pretty good game from the junior box. I think they played really well, and there's a few players for Springbok fans to keep an eye on in the coming years. For Argentina, they had sort of a little bit of a consolation prize. Juan Pablo Castro was selected as the World Rugby Breakthrough Player of the tournament. And then in the final, the former, former champions France beat Australia by 1 point to retain their title. It was obviously a very tightly contested game, as reflected in the scoreline. And interesting that French rugby, the French national team isn't really in a good place at the moment. They had an abysmal Six Nations campaign, but it seems like they've got some good young players coming up, so maybe some hope for them in the future. And then just in schoolboy rugby, St. Stithians hosted St. John's, and I got to go to this game. And St. John's finished off their season by winning by 52 points to 33. I thought both teams were relatively weak on defense. St. John's centre, Jack Montgomery, scored a great solo try in the first half. St. Stithians got a yellow card for a deliberate knockdown in the second half, and from there, St. John's took full advantage. They scored a try and converted soon after. The St. John's left wing, Daniel Deeks, had a great game. He scored two tries. His second try was really impressive. He beat a man on his outside and showed some really good pace. For St. Stithians, their fullback, Munashi Chaitezwi, he had another great game. He's highly rated by the Lions Rugby Union, and he's one to keep an eye on, I think, for the future. So for those of you Lions supporters, you've possibly got a very good prospect on the way. St. John's overall had a fantastic season. They only lost to Jeppe, Kingswood, and St. Andrews, and they drew with King Edward High School across the road from St. John's. So, yeah, things very much on the up and up for St. John's rugby. This is already the third episode in this series, in this podcast, but I thought I would introduce a new element this week, sort of the All Blacks. I'll call it the All Blacks Spotlight. where I'll just talk about one thing regarding the All Black national team now leading up to the World Cup, because there'll be a lot more news coming out. And this is what sort of prompted me here was an article by Mark Reason. He was also writing on stuff.co.nz, so that's stuff.co.nz. He said the signs are very good for an All Blacks win at the World Cup, and he's basing his argument on the Super Rugby table. In 2015, the Hurricanes completely dominated the regular season. There were four New Zealand teams that made the playoffs, and the Highlanders beat the Hurricanes in the final. In 2007, South Africa dominated the competition, with the Sharks and Bulls topping the table, and they were in the final. And then they won the World Cup, of course, where they beat England in 2007. And then in 1999, the Reds topped the table and Australia took the World Cup. I guess this is a sort of fun thing to look at the numbers, but I don't like basing what could happen in the future necessarily what has happened in previous competitions, because things are always different every World Cup. Obviously, the players are very different now from what they might have been like in 2007. The coaches are new. The environment is new in Japan. It's not either in Europe or in Australia, New Zealand, or South Africa. So it's a new environment for the players to try and adapt to. I guess it's a fun exercise, and you can let me know if you think he's got anything to go on. Obviously, I like to think that things are looking good for the All Blacks, but going into World Cup, you have to be a bit more careful with these predictions. But just an interesting thing to think about. So I'd like to wrap up on that note, a hopefully positive sign for the All Blacks going into the World Cup based on the Super Rugby performance of their teams. Just in closing, please, a reminder to follow me on Twitter. My handle is at CHRISHATT11. And to also please follow Pod Media, that's at PODMEDIASA. If you're listening to this on YouTube, please remember to subscribe to the channel. That's the big red button underneath this video. You can find this podcast on Apple Podcasts, YouTube, Spotify, CastBox, Google Podcasts, Spreaker, and pretty much any other good podcasting app. So please subscribe and share the link. Share the link with your friends on your Facebook and Twitter accounts, on Pinterest and LinkedIn and Instagram, whatever you guys use nowadays, everything. Please share it as widely as possible. Yeah. I hope you can watch both Super Rugby finals, semi-finals this week. It should be really good rugby, especially that first game between the Crusaders and the Hurricanes. I'm looking forward to that one a lot. Hopefully the Crusaders can pull it through and make it to their third final in 3 years, and then, you know, going from there to clinch the title. If they beat the Hurricanes, then they'll host the final in Christchurch the following week. So my thumbs are, I'm trying to cross as many digits as I can and hold thumbs and hold luck with the Crusaders this weekend. But that being said, the other semi-final between the Jaguares and Brumby should also be really good. So try and watch both those games. And you should also see sort of a few players really coming to the front and trying to make the case for national selection before the World Cup. Right, listeners, I'll end on there. On that note, thank you once again for joining me and for listening to this episode. I look forward to talking to you next week about the Super Rugby semi-finals and all the different permutations and implications. I hope you have a good weekend ahead. And let me know what you thought of the latest games in Super Rugby. End on that one. I'll talk to you again next week. Thank you very much. Bye.